Hello friends, welcome to our YouTube channel Basics of Physics. In our today's thermodynamics lecture series, we will be considering some of the multiple choice questions based on the fourth chapter, that is thermometry. For the today's discussion, I have taken a topics, that is thermometry, its principle, various types of thermometer, various temperature scales which we are using in our day-to-day life, their interconvergence. Based on these topics, we will be discussing some of the important multiple choice questions. So let us start with the today's multiple choice question session. The first multiple choice question is, the bimetallic strips are employed in dash dash thermometer. First option is vapor pressure. Number two, liquid expansion. Option three, metal expansion. Option D, resistance. Now see, we know that bimetallic thermometers is a type of thermometer which are used for the measurement of the temperature. And this bimetallic thermometer, it converts the media temperature into mechanical displacement using a bimetallic strip. So in these types of thermometers, bimetallic strips are used. And these bimetallic strips consist of two different metals having different coefficient of thermal expansion. So the metals which are used in these bimetallic strips, these are having a property of thermal expansion as the temperature of the media increases. So if you look at the option, so in case of bimetallic strips, it is the metal expansion is the main phenomenon which is used. So the answer for this question is the option number C, metal expansion. So the correct way for this answer is bimetallic strips are employed in metal expansion thermometers. Now, second question is, resistance thermometer generally makes use of dash dash for measurement of resistance. Option number A, potentiometer. Option number B, Arduino. Option number C, diode bridge. Option D, Wheatstone bridge. Now see, the schematic which I had shown over here, it represents a resistance thermometer in which you can see the four different kinds of resistance, R1, R2, R3, and this fourth resistance, that is RT. These four resistance are connected across this bridge network that is called as the Wheatstone bridge. And the temperature measured in this one, it is given by RT is equal to R0 in bracket 1 plus alpha T, where RT is the temperature resistance of a resistance at a temperature T degree Celsius. R0 is the temperature of the resistance at temperature 0 degree Celsius. And alpha is known as the temperature coefficient of resistance. Depending upon which resistance thermometer we are using, this value of our coefficient of resistance changes. Now, if you look at this description, then from this one, you can see that it is the Wheatstone network bridge, which is used for the measurement of the temperature in resistance thermometer. So the correct answer for this question is the option number D, Wheatstone bridge. Third question is, liquid expansion thermometers are filled with option A, mercury, option B, amalgam, option D, C, gallium, option D, cesium. Now see, we had seen in liquid expansion thermometer, one of the important property of the material which is used, that is nothing but the thermal expansion coefficient of that material. When you heat the substance or when the temperature of the thermometer is increased, the material which is inside this thermometer, it will expand and it will move inside the capillary which is enclosed in a thermometer. So if you consider from the given options, that is mercury, amalgam, gallium and cesium, out of these, mercury is the only metal which is in liquid state at the room temperature and which has a good thermal expansion coefficient. So if you consider from the given option, it is the mercury which is having a good thermal expansion coefficient. So the correct answer for this question is mercury. Now in some cases, it might happen that instead of mercury, you might be given some ether or alcohol, it will be given in this option. So you have to remember one thing is that as compared to the mercury, alcohol and ether thermometers, they have a high thermal expansion coefficient. So in case of alcohol and ether, if you compare with the mercury, then it is the alcohol and mercury thermometer which will have more thermal expansion coefficient. So instead of mercury, these are the different elements, that is alcohol and ether, which are preferred in the liquid expansion thermometer. So in this case, the correct answer for this question is the option number A, mercury. Now fourth option question is, thermoelectric thermometer is based on dash dash effect, option A, photoelectric effect, option B, Seebeck effect, option C, Compton effect, option D, Joule effect. Now see, we had seen a thermoelectric thermometer, it works on the principle of Seebeck effect. What is this Seebeck effect? You have two different metals, that is copper and iron, it was given in this case. These two metals are connected and one region is kept at the low temperature and another junction is kept at a higher temperature. Whenever you have such a kind of arrangement, then thermo EMF is generated in this circuit. And if you apply a thermometer, voltmeter across this one, you can measure this thermo EMF. And this principle is nothing but called as the Seebeck effect, or this phenomenon is called as the Seebeck effect. So Seebeck effect you can define in this fashion as a phenomenon in which the temperature difference between the two dissimilar metals or conductor produces a voltage difference between the two junctions. So that is nothing but the Seebeck effect. If you consider this, this is the working principle for the thermoelectric thermometer. If you consider the other options such as photoelectric effect, Compton effect and Joule effect, photoelectric effect is related to the light phenomenon. When light is incident on the material, electrons are emitted from the surface. We call it as a photoelectric effect. Compton effect is the scattering of two particles. It is a different phenomenon. Joule effect is also some different kind of phenomenon. So if you look at the option for the given question, then it is the option number B which is correct. So the thermoelectric thermometer is based on the Seebeck effect. Fifth question is, on which of the following scales of temperature the temperature is never negative? Option A, Celsius, option B, Fahrenheit, option C, Reaumur scale, option D, Kelvin scale. Now from this figure you can see it's a Fahrenheit scale, degree Celsius scale and Kelvin scale. Different kinds of thermometer I had shown over here. So in case of a Kelvin scale, the lowest temperature which you can have is the absolute zero, which is called as the 0 degree Kelvin. And the maximum temperature as far as standard reference upper fixed point is considered, that is the boiling point of the water. If you check this one, it means it goes from 0 Kelvin to 373 Kelvin. But if you consider the same scale with respect to Fahrenheit and degree Celsius will go from -273 to 100 degree Celsius, or in Fahrenheit it is -459 degree Fahrenheit to 212 degree Fahrenheit. So it is the Kelvin scale which do not represent a negative value for the given temperature. So the correct answer for this question is option number D. So it's the Kelvin scale of the following which never represents a negative scale. Option D is the correct answer. Sixth question is, the temperature on Celsius scale is 25 degrees Celsius. What is the corresponding temperature on the Fahrenheit scale? These are the options which are given over here, 40, 77, 50, 45. Now see, we know that Celsius scale has been prepared by dividing melting point of water and the boiling point of the water, which is 0 degree and 100 degree, into equal parts. So let us say 1 degree Celsius represents a temperature divided by the 100 intervals. And we know that in the Fahrenheit temperature, lower fixed point is the 32 and the upper fixed point is the 212. So it is a temperature in Fahrenheit minus 32, which is divided into 180 equal parts. So if you further simplify this for TC, you can transfer this 100 from this side to this side. You will get 100 into TF minus 32 divided by 180. Now here in this case, if you consider we have given a temperature of 25 degrees Celsius, and we have to convert this temperature from degree Celsius into Fahrenheit. So if you could transfer this formula for the degree Fahrenheit, we can get this relation 9/5 into TC plus 32. And we'll just substitute this value of temperature in degree Celsius in this expression. So it is 9/5 into 25 plus 32. If I divide this 5 by this 25, if I divide this 25 by this 5, then it will be 5. So 9 into 5, that will be 45 plus 32 as it is, which will give us the value of 77 degree Fahrenheit. So if you look at the option, it is the option B which is showing the correct answer. So 25 degree Celsius represents a 77 degree Fahrenheit. Now seventh question is, no other thermometer is suitable as platinum resistance thermometer to measure the temperature in the range 0 to 100 degree Celsius, 100 to 1500 degree Celsius, 50 to 350 degree Celsius, and 200 to 600 degree Celsius. Now in this case, if you see, it is the temperature range of the platinum resistance thermometer it has been asked to us. So if you look at the option, it is the option D which shows the correct answer, because see, in case of temperature, the platinum resistance thermometer, it is used for the measurement of temperature from 200 degree Celsius to 1200 degree Celsius. So if you look at the option from this one, you can check over here, it is the 200 to 600 degrees Celsius, it is the range which covers the operating range of the platinum resistance thermometer. In addition to this one, let me tell you few things. The temperature measurement through platinum resistance thermometer is easier as compared to the other thermometer, as the platinum resistance thermometer is quite sensitive as compared to the other thermometers, and the meter gives the precise reading of the temperature. So if you look at the option for the given question, it is the option number D which shows the more appropriate answer. So it is the 200 to 600 degree Celsius range in which platinum resistance thermometer is more suitable as compared to the other thermometers. Eighth question is, mercury thermometer can be used to measure temperature up to 100 degree Celsius, 212 degree Celsius, 360 degree Celsius, 500 degree Celsius. The answer for this question is 360 degree Celsius. Now you people might ask me the question, sir, why is it so? Okay. See, in case of a mercury, the freezing point of the mercury is the minus 39 degree Celsius, and the boiling point of the mercury is 357 degree Celsius. So it is the working range of the mercury in between the freezing point and the melting point. So mercury thermometer generally works in between the minus 39 to 357 or 360 degree Celsius. So if you look at the option more precisely, it is the 360 degree Celsius is the temperature maximum up to which a mercury thermometer can be used for the measurement. So it is the option number C. Ninth question is, of the following thermometer, the one which can be used for measuring a rapidly changing temperature is option A, thermocouple thermometer, option B, gas thermometer, option C, maximum resistance thermometer, option D, vapor pressure thermometer. Now see, here in this case, out of which of the following thermometer, one which is used for rapidly changing temperature, means its sensitivity has to be higher, that it has been asked to us in this question. Now if you consider, it is the thermocouple thermometer which gives us the higher sensitivity as far as the rapidity of changing temperature is considered. Okay, what is temperature thermocouple thermometer? Thermocouple thermometer, it works on the principle of Seebeck effect, which I had seen in our earlier question, in which two metal junctions of two dissimilar metal junction, one at a higher temperature and one at a lower temperature, they will be maintained at a two different temperatures. So due to that one, a EMF, it will be developed between these two, and this EMF, it will be measured in terms of a volt meter, which will be further calibrated with the help of some appropriate calibration technique. So, and due to this one, thermocouple thermometer, it gives the higher sensitivity for the rapidly changing the thermometer temperature scales. Okay, so the correct answer for this question, it's the thermocouple thermometer, which is widely used for the measuring a rapidly changing temperature. Option A is the correct answer for this question. 10th question is, a device used to measure high temperature is? Option A, pyrometer. Option B, thermometer. Option B, bolometer. Option D, calorimeter. All of us know that the calorimeter is a device which is used for the measurement of a heat. Okay, so obviously the option D is not correct. Okay, and now we have to decide among the rest three options, that is pyrometer, thermometer and bolometer. Let me discuss one by one. What is the pyrometer? Pyrometer is an instrument that measures the temperature remotely. What do you mean by remotely? By measuring the radiation from the distant object without having a physical contact with that object. Okay, so it is measuring the radiations coming from that body. Okay, and that radiations, with the help of that one, this pyrometer measures the temperature of the body, and that is nothing but the pyrometer. A pyrometer is a type of remote sensing thermometer used to measure high temperature of the surfaces of the different objects. Now in this pandemic situation, you might have seen a IR gun is there. When you need to thermal scanning in a crowded places, this kind of thermometers are used, that is called as the IR gun as well. Okay, so it is the option A, it is pyrometer, which is the device used for the measurement of such a temperature. So it's a remote sensing device which works on the principle of the IR technology. 11th question is, a gas filled thermometer works on the principle of option A, Peltier effect, option B, thermoelectric effect, option C, Charles law and Boyle's law, option D, Seebeck effect and Peltier effect. Now see, it is the gas filled thermometers it has been given to us. Now we know that whenever gas is the working substance is there in case of a thermometer, as depending upon the heat provided to the thermometer, the system can expand or it will have an expansion. So in gas filled thermometer, thermal expansion or change in volume or change in pressure with respect to temperature, it is the parameter which is used for the measurement of the temperature. So if you look out of the given options, it is the Charles law and the Boyle's law which relates the change in the volume and pressure. Okay, which relates the change in pressure and volume for a given temperature. So if you look at the option, then it is the option C which represents the correct answer. So it is the Boyle's law and the Charles law on the basis of which the gas filled thermometer works. Now next question is 12. The relation between resistance and temperature in resistance thermometer is? First question answer is E is equal to AT plus T square. Option B, RT is equal to R0 in bracket 1 plus alpha T. Option C, RT is equal to R0 T. Option D, V is equal to R. Now see, if you get such a kind of questions in this your graduation exam or in any competitive exam, you can solve this type of questions with the help of a dimension analysis. Now we know that in physics, if you want to have any physical equation which has to be correct, then for that purpose the dimensions of the RHS and the dimensions of the LHS has to be same. If you look at the option number A, okay, it is E is equal to AT plus T square. In this case, A is constant, let us say, because it has not been given to us what is A. If it is constant, then this T and T square, they are not having the same dimensions, because dimension of T square will not be equal to the dimension of T. So you will not be having the option A to be the correct answer. Now let us check about the option number D, V is equal to IR. It is a Ohm's law, which is obviously not used, because not a every resistance thermometer, it can follow the Ohm's law. Okay, and the option C, so this is option D is not the answer, option A is not the answer. If you look at the option C, RT is equal to R0T. So in that case, this RT and R0, they are having a same dimensions, but this T, which is a temperature at T degree Celsius, which is the temperature at the T degree Celsius. So this equation also do not satisfy the dimension condition. So that is also dimensionally not correct. So if you look at it, is the RT is equal to R0 plus 1 plus alpha T. It is the correct answer for this question. So option B is the correct answer in this question. Okay. Next question is 68 degree Fahrenheit in degree Celsius will be 40, 20, 36, 45. We know that 1 degree Celsius, there is nothing but it is the temperature between the boiling point and the freezing point of the water, which is divided into 100 equal point, or which is divided into 100 equal parts. One such part is called as the 1 degree Celsius. One such part is called as the 1 degree Celsius. So TC divided by represents the 1 degree Celsius. Now, what is degree Fahrenheit? It is the 32 degree more as compared to the degree Celsius, and that interval, it is divided into the 180 equal parts. So it is temperature in Fahrenheit minus 32, it is divided into 180 equal parts. So if you rearrange this equation for TC, you will get TC is equal to 100 into TF minus 32 divided by 100. Now in this case, it is the 68 degree Fahrenheit, it is the temperature which we need to convert. So let us substitute TF is equal to 68 in this question. So 68 minus 32, it will be 36. So 36 divided by 180 as it is into 100. If we further simplify, 18 ones are 18, 18 twos are 36, and 18 twos are 10s are 180. So we can cancel this zero with this zero. Okay. So you'll get 10 into 2, which will be nothing but 20 degrees Celsius. If you look at the option, then it is the option B which shows the correct answer. So 68 degrees Fahrenheit, it represents the 20 degrees Celsius in the Celsius scale. That's it for the today's session. I hope you people have enjoyed the today's lecture. If you like the video, please hit the like button in the video. And if you are having any doubts, please comment me in the comment section so that I can reply to your comments. And if you are not subscribed to our channel, please subscribe to our channel, Basics of Physics by Professor Ravi Kiran Lathe. That's it for the today's session. We'll stop here for today's lecture. Thank you.